And the FTC has just updated their guidelines for social media influencers, and they finally have made something really simple and digestible. Before, these things were very long and I think hard for a lot of people to follow. They have now made things, I think, a lot easier to consume and will hopefully help more influencers follow the law. So let's take a look at what they've put together. You can find the guide here at ftc.gov/influencers. So this is it for the guide. It's not very long. They tell you when to disclose, which means anytime you have a financial, employment, personal, or family relationship with a brand and you're covering that brand on your channel or your Instagram page or whatever, you've got to disclose the relationship. Pretty simple stuff. They give you a lot of guidelines for making those disclosures clear to viewers. And they also give you some ideas as to how to best make those disclosures depending on the platform. So for example, if it's a picture on a platform like Snapchat, you should be superimposing the disclosure over the picture to make sure that viewers have enough time and notice to see it. And this is important because even though that seems like a lot of work to do, you or the brand that you're working with can end up in a lot of hot water if you don't do it. So there's a real good reason maybe to put that time in. When I first started doing my disclosures on the channel, a lot of folks said, why can't you just put it in the description rather than taking 20 seconds in the video to do it? Well, here's why. When making a video, the disclosure should be in the video and not just in the description. Viewers are more likely to notice disclosures made in both audio and video form. Some viewers may watch without sound and others may not notice superimposed words. Additionally, what happens with YouTube is that if you're on a TV, you're not seeing the description at all, which is why it's important to make these disclosures very clear at the beginning of the video so viewers know about it. This was interesting for live streamers. If you're doing a live stream, you need to repeat the disclosure periodically so viewers who come in later can get the disclosure, just like those who were in earlier. So if you're doing live streaming with a brand, you'll probably want to bring that up every once in a while. And again, follow the rules for video, which means that you need to do both a video and video visual and an audio one as well. I may need to start putting some words up on screen to mirror what I am saying, just in case people are watching without sound. So I need to keep that in mind for future disclaimers. They also suggest that you use simple and clear language, because in the past when we've seen influencers acting in ways that they should not, they get cute with it. Hey, I'm working with this brand, or so-and-so asked me to do this for them, without actually saying, hey, they paid me to do it, which is what the case was in most of those instances. See my rant on the Dyson vacuum cleaner debacle from last year to get a better idea as to that. So they suggest you make very simple explanations like, hey, thanks Acme for the free product, or use terms like advertisement, ad, and sponsored so that people are aware. All of this stuff is about making sure the audience very clearly understands the relationship. If you're being paid to do something, you need to say you were paid through one of these words that viewers would typically associate with somebody being paid. They said, don't assume that the platform's disclosure tools are good enough either. But consider using it in addition to your own good disclosure. So that's important stuff to follow. What else to know? You can't talk about an experience with a product that you haven't tried. And I think that's important also, because you can speculate and say that it's speculation, but you can't lie to your audience and say that I tried this product and it's crap when you haven't actually tested it at all. That leaves you open to potentially a libel lawsuit, perhaps. So you need to be aware of that beyond whatever FTC issues are there. If you're paid to talk about a product and thought it was terrible, you can't say that it's awesome. That's important. I've turned away a lot of sponsorships because I didn't think their product was all that great. So that's an important thing to keep in mind as well. And this is an important one, about especially products that relate to health and like those dietary supplements and all that CBD garbage you keep hearing on TV. You can't make up claims about a product that would require proof that the advertiser doesn't have, such as scientific proof that a product can treat a health condition. And that could leave you liable not only for FTC issues, but also perhaps civilly if somebody was harmed by a product that you said would cure them of something and it didn't, or perhaps created an even worse health effect. This is the kind of stuff you need to be aware of. You know, really, online, even as an influencer with a small following on YouTube, You have as much responsibility as a broadcaster that's reaching millions of people, and you have to follow the law, and you have to be truthful with people, and you can't just make up stuff even if the brand is paying you to do that. So good things here from the FTC. My pick of the week this week is a video that they did to help you digest this a little bit better. It's not all that long. In fact, it's only about a minute long, but I think it's really helpful to watch the video and then go back and look at these new materials that they've put together. This stuff isn't difficult, but I think it's important for people to follow so that this industry doesn't get considered to be just one big cesspool of fraud. This is about doing things right to ensure that this industry can grow. And I think people need to have faith and trust in the influencers that they're watching. And you gain a lot by being truthful with people, and you lose nothing by disclosing relationships that you have. I have seen this in my own experience here, that I think people understand that you've got to get sponsors every once in a while. And as long as you disclose it up front, the viewer can make the judgment as to whether or not what they're about to hear is something that is accurate or not. And it's up to viewers to make those decisions, and they can't make those decisions if they don't have the information. So be upfront, disclose, 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 and check out the new FTC materials, which I think will help you immensely. And by the way, this is a United States thing, but if you're making videos overseas and those videos are coming into the United States, they're going to be under the same type of regulations, especially if the brands you're working with are selling things in the US. You may be not liable as a citizen of another country, but that company could be based on what you are doing on their behalf. So there's a lot of need here to study this stuff and follow the law. And in many cases, your own country's laws will be very similar to what the FTC imposes on me here in the U.S. Let me know what you think down in the comments below.
This channel is brought to you by the Lon.TV supporters, including gold-level supporters, the Four Guys with Quarters podcast, Chris Allegretta, Tom Albrecht, Brian Parker, and Kalyan Kumar. If you want to help the channel, you can by contributing as little as a dollar a month. Head over to lon.tv/support to learn more. And don't forget to subscribe. Visit lon.tv/s.